we spoke a bit in practical terms about actually the awakening process and a traumatized nervous system. And actually, it's important to recognize that when you're doing this process with a nervous system that's been traumatized, it's not shadow work. It's not like a deep emotional recess that you can access and play with. We're talking about the physiognomy of this being shifted into the most primal energetic states at birth, because the most advanced energetic states of co-regulation, community, love and connection, you know, the human states that we've developed in society to help us regulate, they're offline, they're gone. No words, no conversations in those stages when you're, let's say, in full nervous system freeze because of past trauma. No words are going to help it. The body's absolutely, on the most fundamental level, just gone into shock, you know. And you start, yeah. It starts coming alive sometimes during the awakening process. You start feeling, oh, actually, this nervous system, this body has been deeply conditioned way beyond mind. Actually, it's in the bones, it's in the blood, it's in the cells. Mm-hmm. And I found a great book recently. So there's a lady called Ali Wise who was posting a few things on Instagram, and she was posting just like little snippets, but every one of them was just like straight to the heart and felt just like, I was saying to a friend of mine, Sam Roth, who does some really nice things on YouTube about managing trauma and working with social anxiety and awakening. I've just sent him a recommendation of it, saying it feels state of the art. What I mean by it feels state of the art, it's like this combination of all the different fields of trauma and care and awakening coming together in this really loving expression of how to meet a nervous system that's been, well, yeah, badly abused and traumatized. You know, it doesn't have to be physical abuse either. It's just been traumatized. Well, one thing that she points out, which is really central, is that she talks about the ventral vagal and the dorsal vagal systems. But what they're basically saying is the newer part of our evolutionary, you could say, nervous system, and the older part, you know, one is 500 million years old. The other one is half that, you know, so it's a much more new one. And what I mean by that is that actually the communication, co-regulation, society, community, conversations like this in order for us to regulate each other with healthy nervous systems, that's very new in comparison to the lizard brain, the brain stem that is just, will instantly flick you into freeze or fight flight, like instantly do it. Like, so this new brain thing, this new brain capacity to co-regulate with others, if that's offline, which it goes offline because of continual abuse, no questioning, no words, no conversations, no guy at the top of a well telling you to get better is going to get you better. You have to go back to the source, back into the being, into the energetics. I need to convince that system there's safety. Because that's what it's saying, is that there's no safety here. There's no safety. I'm under threat. There's no safety. But it's no words. It's the absolute core of your being going, danger, 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 danger. So how do you then convince that to calm down enough so that then we can move up the dorsal, or sorry, the vagal ladder, you could call it, to start doing this, to start co-regulating each other in conversation and community. But if you speak to anybody who's deep in the recess of like traumatized crisis, this does not work. You can't do this. It's life and death. The body is in life and death, and they disconnect often from feelings, thoughts, emotions, sometimes into dissociative disorders, you know. So yeah, it's important to recognize, well, actually, what basic things can we do to help regulate the oldest part of our survival mechanism? And gentle touch, like we talked about before, which was missing from our, you know, developmental stages when we're in childhood, that seems to be a really good place to start. For me, it was the wrist. For whatever reason, for me, just gently stroking my wrist and my hand, it goes straight there for me. It's the thing that goes straight to that place and offers a physiological sense of safety that no words can touch, really.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's tricky though, isn't
it? I have nothing to say. That's a beautiful, I think people should, I want to pull that as a clip and release it specifically because this is so important. We think we can bypass our ancient conditioning, which I actually use this model here, this elephant and rider model of Jonathan Haidt's, to talk about, like, kind of, there's lizard brain, there's like a little bit less lizard brain, unconscious,
and then the prefrontal cortex. There's our neocortex. Yeah, exactly,
exactly. And what we do is we ignore, we think we're all frontal cortex, and that we can top down manage this. You cannot. You have to speak to the elephant that you're riding on, because it's going to go where it's going to go, and you're just its press secretary.
And it doesn't understand words. So, that's the thing. It doesn't understand the words. Yeah, I know.
It doesn't. It understands energetic emotion. It understands touch. It understands fight or flight hormones. It understands abuse on an energetic level. It never forgets. The elephant never forgets. So how do you manage that? And, you know, when I used to talk in healthcare, I would say we're all the rider right now. We're all the neocortex on this. And we're forgetting that humans are mostly elephant. And so we're telling people, get vaccinated, you know, do this, do this. And what their elephant is hearing is, oh, remember when I was six and I was strapped down by a couple nurses and got six injections at once and I didn't know what it was and it just felt like danger. Now you're asking me to do that to my child. The elephant's like, nope. And that's it. Then the writer goes and Googles vaccine's bad, right? And finds a million articles. So it's that motivated reasoning. But with trauma, I've not heard it expressed so clearly about trauma as you've expressed here. And you said Allie Wise, maybe we can put a link to her book.
Yeah, so I'm kind of midway through it now. The book I've got, it's like an online book, so it's PDF only, but it's called Embodied Healing. And it's about as good as anything I've read. You know, I've read Bessel van der Kolk's The Body Keeps a Score and a lot of other trauma-related books. This feels like a natural progression of that. It's really, really beautiful. And so if you have experienced like complex PTSD, PTSD, traumatic early childhood experiences, or you're coming into these trapped traumatic energies, this is a really beautiful way to slowly start opening up this new way of being. And what's beautiful as well is she explicitly says, this path is a path of awakening. And it's like, that's good. And she says, and also, there's not many more potent paths for awakening than this. And of course there isn't. Because if you get to the root of this, you're really going to know what this is about. But yeah, I think it's, and the reason that obviously I mentioned it because it's been part of my experience, and it's been a bit of your experience, but also, how do I put this? If we're putting things into the world and we know there's going to be people listening that may have had these experiences, surely we have a responsibility to be trauma informed. I think we do. From the point of view of some people expressing truth, and they are expressing truth, they're expressing truth from a place of actually being able to easily inhabit the ventral vagal system and have very well adapted co-regulation mechanisms in community and in conversation and in families. So actually they don't have this ancient nervous system that's just bypassing that instantaneously. So then being able to say, well, actually you can transcend the trauma by doing this method and asking this question and all that. It's like, well, those that really have experienced the trauma go, what are you talking about? That doesn't, like, I just feel more traumatized. That's not working.
Yeah, that's right.
So you need you need different
things. And not seen.
Not seen.
Too. Like, you're not seen. You're clearly not seen because you're not understanding what this is. And I love that we have an obligation if we're going to put this out in the world to be trauma-informed. That is beautifully put, because think of the harm you can do to a huge part of the population that is traumatized. At some level, we're all traumatized, right?
For sure.
There's degrees. So I'm going to try to read this book, because I feel like that has been a big blind spot in my own unfolding. because sometimes, and in medicine, we're so conditioned, again, to keep ourselves safe.
Yeah.
When I encounter strong trauma as a physician, there's a natural pulling back and trying to hide behind the clinical facade because it's so powerful. Yeah. You feel the suffering and you can't, the separate self can't take it.
Yeah.
And it's just afraid,
yeah,
like afraid of what's hiding here too.
Yeah.
So there's a wall that goes up, and I learned that early in my training, and it's pounded into you again and again and again. And so this process of unbinding all of that and opening has come with a lot of recognition that, okay, so now I have a big blind spot.
Uh-huh.
Like what is like severe abuse in childhood?
Yeah.
How does that show up?
Yeah, yeah.
How do I speak to that? How do I feel that?
Huh?
When I had a relatively good childhood, but the traumas that I had were so impactful.
Yeah,
like exactly. Feel so... have such a gravity.
Yeah.
And by comparison, in an absolute sense, you're like, well, but there's no comparison. So,
but it's not about, there is comparison there. And this is one of the, like the myths and kind of storylines that we tell ourselves, that we say there's no comparison between a person that was sexually assaulted and beaten and abused and me. We often say that, don't we? But actually what we find is in the first 2 to 3 years of our life, if the child is, their basic needs are not met. It's that simple. Their basic needs are not met, and they, because what they need is a sense of safety, guidance, connection, and love, and being seen, and to be around other nervous systems that help them to co-regulate. So no, you know, if it's, from an awakening point of view, we can sense that there's no duality, there's no two. So actually, we've just got these interrelated nervous systems that are responding to the environment and each other. They are, then there's no difference between this nervous system and your nervous system, other than, well, there is a difference, an apparent difference, but it's interrelated. You know, we're vibing together. So that bond between a young child and their primary caregiver is that's it. That's all their life is. It's entirely that. And if that's dysfunctional, that can have a deep, deep impact. And it can be just as simple as the parent leaving their child to cry all night again and again and again. Like, can you think about what that'll do for a child in fear? You know, and I get why it happens, but what we're finding, at least what the research seems to be finding, is that actually has a really detrimental impact, you know, because it's pre-verbal, unable to understand what's going on in the world. They're just met with instantaneous fear and abandonment. And what they get, they're trying to vocalize, and what they get is nothing. They get the abandonment that they fear. Like, so then if that becomes an archetype throughout the rest of your life, then you're going to be moving from that place of fear, and you're going to be manifesting abandonment issues in your life for the rest of your life. You know, this is why we talk about, or people talk about attachment theory quite a lot, because it's these attachments that we form in early life. So it might seem different. And I know it is different as in like what actually played out, but what they're finding is the effects of emotional neglect early on in life, it has exactly the same impact on the nervous system, exactly the same impact. And just, and it basically shuts down that co-regulating ventral vagal communication part of the brain. In fact, it never develops, never fully develops. And what we then do at like a very early age, we just operate from the oldest survival mechanism, which is normally fight, flight. And if that doesn't work, get even older. Shut down, shut down, shut down, shut down, shut down.
Freeze.
And fawn and try to stop it from happening. And we fawn and we try and people please. So, yeah, it's a really fascinating area to explore, isn't it? Really. But why not like explore this? Especially if we're going to communicate about consciousness and well-being, which we are doing, and other people are. Why not be trauma-informed? Because you will meet people that have suffered trauma. And if you don't really understand or feel into how trauma works and has injured people, then you can re-traumatize them. And you can especially re-traumatize them as a teacher, telling them to just go into the heart of the trauma when they can't. I mean, they absolutely can't. Yeah. It's re-traumatizing. And you're getting people saying, just be with it. Just go deeper. Love it more. It's like, I see what you're doing, but... that capacity is not online yet. They're like, it's a tricky thing. Yeah.
this is I mean, this is the deepest stuff actually of human conditioning, like, because you're talking at the earliest days, and if you imagine where these energetic fluctuations of pattern, and we're all interrelated, like you say, which is a realization, it's not something we imagine, you can realize this, then any sort of perturbation early on, and by the way, this is important to say, this is innocent. The parents are innocent.
Yeah, exactly.
The situation is innocent. Yeah. The child is innocent. This is just how things, cause and conditions, come together, and that child is conditioned. That pattern of energetics vibrates out into the future and self-reinforces in certain ways, so that ways that the child learns to pacify might be to go into imagination or thought and create a thought-constructed world. It might be people-pleasing. It might be seeking attention. It might be all these things. And that is just the path of that child. That's fine. What can happen, the good news is, later, with these trauma-informed strategies, you can get the resources to reach the deepest trauma and go from that fight-or-flight lizard brain, fight, flight, or freeze, to a higher co-regulatory function, to a self-co-regulatory function, to where now you're co-regulating with yourself, to now noticing something that would happen at, again, I keep bringing it back to retreat because I can't not talk about my own experience because I'm a narcissist. Actually, because that's just how it is, it shows up. So what I'd notice is thoughts would arise, and they would be particular thoughts about a person or an event or a thing, and they would start to launch. And naturally, what would then happen is I'd go, okay, this is clearly a response to something energetic that's happening and has been happening for a long time. Where's that? And attention would go right into the body. Yeah. And contrary to how it is when we're very thought identified, now there was enough meditative presence or just general allowance, surrender in a way, that it went right to where it was. And it was surprising every time. It was some emotional resonance that was the primary thing that was then triggering a flight into thought, and then the reflections in the pool of consciousness just pop, 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 and attention just being stuck there, and that feeling like suffering because it's an avoidance of what's actually here, which is this. So then you dive into that and you realize, oh, it's a little bit of fear, a fear of not being good enough, and it's reflected as all these stories. And who knows when that happened? And then launching into actually feeling back into childhood and going, remember that time when you were so, you fell in love. This was my own story. You were so in love with living things. Plants in particular were fascinating, and that you dug up these plants from the nearby forest and you replanted them in a garden. And these neighboring kids who were kind of the bullies of the neighborhood came, made fun of you, physically threatened you, and tore all the plants out.
Oh man,
And that was the first time you might have felt here, it felt feeling right here, that it's not okay to love something so much because it's gonna be taken away, or it's gonna look bad, or you're gonna lose the support of community, or you're gonna be physically in danger. And now when I feel love for people, I contract into thought and go, why am I worried about other people? I'm here for my own retreat. And then feeling into the body and going, oh my God, that's what it was.
Yeah.
And this all happening naturally.
Yeah. Wow.
And how could you possibly have that sequence of insights happen if you're still terrified, if there's still the deepest fight or flight?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So I see exactly what you're pointing at.
Yeah, it's incredible, isn't it, when that... For me, when that first started to happen, it, again, this is just an analogy, but it felt like a golden thread had been found that went right into the deepest seat of my being, back to earliest childhood. And I was able to follow that thread down and almost from that event see the unfolding of all of the coping mechanisms that had flowered throughout my experience. And you're just like, oh, that relationship, that thing... made me do the all like be this way blindly, blindly do it. I didn't,
and it's innocently, like, innocently too, blindly,
exactly.
Yeah,
man. Oh, this is so good.
Wow,
isn't it good? This,
oh man, this is good.
It's, so fun.
It's better than good.
Yeah,
it's the good news. It's the good news. It's like, this is unwindable, this is addressable. You're not broken, you never were broken.
And it's so it's nice hard to talk
and
about,
no one
like,
should tell you just.
Well, I was going to, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt with a bit of lag. Yeah,
no, exactly. I got
nothing. You're right. I mean, the fact that it's nobody's fault and there is a way to work with this. And also, you're not alone, you know, I know, and I'm speaking to both you directly, Zubin, and also those others. It's like, you're not alone. We are here for each other. Mm. This is what we can do for each other, you know, and isn't that is good news, because this is how we rebuild community. And this is how we, you could say, retake our life back as humans on the planet, is that we start exploring this with each other. Why not? You know, what else? In fact, what else are we going to do?
What else is there?
Yeah, exactly.
You want to get more stuff? Well, what are you going to do with it?
Yeah, I mean, it's all going to go in an impending climate disaster soon anyway. So, like, you've got, what, 15 years? Like,
or nuclear war.
Make the most of it. Yeah, exactly. and it's been really nice because, like...
Let's love each other.